you can actually dive him under the turret almost.
And what a difference a couple of years makes. Top Rengar to being the best cautious top laner.
All right, so Annie and Kalista, the first bans to hit the board. There is the Azir against Frozen. GBM really not going to be early picking that champion. Annie falls by the wayside, a more common ban in Korea these days. Now, the Evelynn, interestingly enough, against Chaser. Definitely not one of Chaser's more heavily prioritized picks when we compare it to something like Ekko or Nidalee or even Rek'Sai's most played champion.
And Jhin Air is actually the team that's banning Hard Engage. Usually we see the likes of the Hard Engage picked against them because, of course, they love to go these Pokemons. They love the Nidalee jungle that hasn't been target banned this series.
But we see the Braum ban coming in, and that means quite possibly that the Runeglaive Ezreal is going to be coming through in some sort of capacity. If I was IM, I might be thinking about taking that Ezreal right now because Jhin Air cannot respond with... I mean, they can respond with the Yasuo. That's about what they've got right now as an effective way to block a lot of those Runeglaive Ezreal spells. Alistar already locked in, taking that pick away from Ignar.
And GBM's answer to Frozen's Cassiopeia was the Yasuo, you know, many months back when we saw this reverse matchup. Sweet, he hasn't played since the 3rd of June for this Jhin Air team. That was when he was Bard bans in full effect. Funnily enough, the only other Bard player we'd really think about is Madlife, who was actually getting Bard bans recently. So, look, it's a lot of talk about this champion. With Alistar locked in, we're not going to see it this game, but there's a hope it comes out as this series goes on.
Indeed. So, the victor looks like it will be prioritized here by Jhin Air. Of course, Jhin Air really likes to blind pick that champion, as do a few other teams, but Jhin Air has a very special priority on the victor. And, no, it's not going to be the Kennen, I don't think. And now, just waiting for these picks to be locked in. Pretty standard Kog'Maw and Gragas. What will Pilot be playing here?
It's crazy to think that blind picking Kog'Maw in the first round on red side is now the new standard. But again, the meta evolving away from the likes of the Shyvana top, the likes of just the tank Cinderhulk champions with the Cinderhulk enchant being nerfed so heavily. Getting to the backline's hard. Only Maokai really presents himself as a reliable backline threat. It's one of the reasons why we see Maokai Kog'Maw as a very common same round of the draft pick. Gragas was the pickup, though, over the Maokai, and now Jhin Air do have someone to lock down. Speaking of backline lockdown, Twisted Fate for GBM.
And this makes a lot of sense, right? Because they have enough engage, they have the Maokai to deal with a possible Ezreal pick, even though there's some good peel from the Janna. So this is going to be a little bit more of a difficult game to actually play a Runeglaive Ezreal in if you are Incredible Miracle. They could go for something a little bit more standard, but they kind of lack some good engage. They have a Gragasult to work with. Also, I want to point out that GBM is using Teleport right now with the Twisted Fate. This is something that Pawn has been doing for EDG in the LPL. It's very interesting. It's great against Runeglaive Ez, and I'll get down to brass tacks on that in a minute if we actually see it locked in.
Definitely a flexible option. You'd think without the gold, without the ghost, you lose out on those multiple gold cards. Without the ignite, you lose out on gank pressure. But it is another flexible choice. And if Twisted Fate does anything, it's tailor his builds, tailor his summoner spells towards the type of game and the type of comp that a team's trying to run.
Yeah, we'll see if GBM sticks with the TP. Obviously, what this does is you primarily use the TP to get back to mid lane so that you can push up the wave and give yourself more opportunities to ult into the side lanes. He's got some great choices here. He's got hard CC in both of his side lanes. So basically, you're just trying to abuse the other mid laner's recall timings to just have more presence in the mid lane while you don't lose farm and experience and maximize the amount of time that you can go for these ganks. Now, obviously, the ganks are riskier in that regard because without the ghost, maybe you don't actually secure that kill. But when you have a Maokai and you have an Alistar, you're probably going to get some kills even with this just running that TP.
And Maokai and Nidalee have excellent synergy when you're talking about ganking top. You targeted root into the max range spears, massive burst damage. One thing I want to touch on with that teleport, think about the fact that the one thing Runeglaive Ezreal can do is chunk out low health members. The base stats of Twisted Fate are disgustingly low. So even after the very early laning phase, the ability to instantly return mid, ensure that your turret stays up, could prove invaluable.
Yeah, and I think it's good that IM decided to go for the Victor instead of the Runeglaive Ez here, because that pressure from TF is huge against a Runeglaive Ezreal. Mm. And so at least they have a little bit better early wave clear. Won't be quite so easy for GBM to get some of these ults off. Well, guys, we are going to be going into game one right now. IM versus Jhenair.
Massive cheers from the IM audience as we start this game.
IM fans, you know, you have to go through a lot over the years to be an incredible Miracle fan. Rare playoff appearances for this team. Constantly trying to battle their way back into the upper echelons, being the gatekeeper, really, for the amateur scene.
So where would you, if you had to compare, say, to an NA and EU LCS team, who would be IM in these other regions? Teams that are kind of always trying to aspire towards those playoff spots, but honestly, never really even impacting playoffs, let alone threatening the top spots.
I don't know. It's not. I don't think there is really
Dignitas.
Maybe Dignitas, but Dignitas has been in more playoffs.
It's true.
I don't know if there is a really apt comparison.
But they've just been always around and always relevant. Kind of maybe an overstatement, but always a contender, specifically in the preseason, and then falling away 3-4 weeks into the season.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I am starting to stack on the bottom side here. Looks like they will be going for a little bit of a delayed five-man invade.
You feel like they're kind of contesting the saplings with this invade, just trying to see what's happening on the bottom side of the jungle. Often we see multiple different flexible starts onto the wraiths, whether it's saplings to allow GBM to pick up the first load. You know, maybe you can just take the wild cards and pick up some experience that way. Maokai picking up the selfish small sapling experience. Either way, the contention comes through. But it looks like, at least, they're going to be able to pick up a few, as with the picker card, you just throw a red card in and potentially get some experience.
Yep, and that's exactly what's going to happen. So small advantage there for GBM. And we are seeing a lane swap occur right now. Chaser will be starting on the red buff, so this Janna harassment not really going to do a whole lot. As Maokai there on the side, you can see, just trying to zone this Janna out. Meanwhile, freezes will be accomplished for both teams via the AD carry.
What about this pathing, though? Because what we've seen develop in these lane swap situations is that people love to start on the big buff on the weak side, just because it's so hard for the support to contest it. Feels like if you start on the Raptors and then go to red buff, that's too much of an overextension. You can see on the minimap, though, Tucson actually started on the strong side of the map.
Yep, and that means he can actually start Gromp and then go for the blue buff afterwards. So it's a little bit of a difference. We do see Expression here coming in. And IM, now they picked for a strong laning phase here. They wanted the Gnar into the Maokai. They wanted the Kog'Maw into the Sivir. So this is a pretty preferable situation for Jhenair right now. Plus, you have kill pressure onto Victor with TF and Alistar on the Roam. So definitely a much better situation for Jhenair early.
Remember, IM invaded for Vision and then opted into a lane swap and not getting that Gnar versus Maokai matchup. That only gets better for Maokai. The early laning phase, very, very good for Gnar. After a single item, especially if Gnar can't get a very fast Hex Drinker. Remember, we saw the infamous solo kill when we last cast on Saturday between these lineups, which never see Maokai solo killing a Gnar, but Trace was on the unfortunate end of the solo kill. He'll remember how this matchup goes, given how much he struggled in it.
Yeah.
Against KT.
Well, here we go. Looks like support's in the top lane, at least for the moment. And we didn't even mention, but Chaser, probably the most feared Nidalee player in Korea. He has such a huge effect on that champion, and it's one of those rare junglers where if you do get a lot of gold, you can do a lot of damage and help carry the team in the late game.
It's a return to Chaser on Nidalee, because in that series against KT, wasn't banned against him in game one, didn't opt for it. And kind of one of the things I was thinking about as you were saying, okay, meta's moving away from Jhenair. The one thing we've talked about in previous patches is that the poke is very certainly in the meta. It's just a weird kind of anachronism where you have good poke champion players, you have people with extended champion pools, specifically GBM, who feels like can play everything, but it still feels like something is missing to really bring the cohesion of this Jhenair lineup in a meta that, at least on one level, should at least support them being a relevant player.
Yeah, it's just, again, I think it's their emphasis on where they put the gold, because while it is a poke meta, a lot of that poke these days has to come out of mid and to a certain degree top laners. And when you have a team that really emphasizes 80 carries like Jhenair does, sure, you have a Corki and a Kog'Maw. Kog'Maw probably the most relevant champion for poke, considering that throughout all stages of the game, considering you're dealing with a narrow timing window. I mean, the other thing that we talk about with Jhenair, too, is that they can play some very good League of Legends, but then they'll make a mistake in the ultra-late game and just lose.
I mean, I guess I come back to the fact that, you know, you have to say it's their AD carry that they put priority on just because we have the stats. We know that both Trace and GBM don't pick up much gold or do much damage, specifically output much damage. They have very low percentage of team damage numbers. But surely the carry is Chaser, as weird as that sounds.
Yeah. Which is why I think that Nidalee ban is actually
needed. Necessary. That's the strategic, that's the only real, true jungle carry. Of course, you can get 6-7 kills on the likes of Evelynn, as we've seen Wisdom do for Ku and carry a game. But Nidalee is the true du jour jungle carry.
Well, you also just don't even need those kills, right?
Sure, to fair. It only gets better.
Yeah, you can farm with Nidalee and you still get items and you still can deal damage. So, yes, I think that is probably a more necessary ban than you might think against Jhenair.
Was it a mistake not taking the Maokai in the first round, do you think Gragas was really the priority jungler? Now, Tucson is an excellent Gragas. It just feels like the only champion that's relevant, that has a decent laning phase, that can get on the backline, that can actually shut down these Kog'Maws. Kog'Maw has the highest win rate by far of any champion picked over 10 times in champions at 74%. Feels like the only way to really get on top of him is this Maokai, and Jhenair could even pair it with the Nidalee that's given them so much success.
Well, they also have the TF too once that Zhonya's comes through, so Jhenair really does have a lot of opportunities to shut down Incredible Miracle's opposition. Pilot there with a quick spell shield onto the Tornado, so...
Is Pilot a carry? Is Captain Jack a carry? These are questions that I don't really know the answer to. And one of them needs to loom as a carry, otherwise, again, it's a team that doesn't really have a threat outside of the jungle.
Yeah, Jhenair is in a very weird place right now. I mean, we've mentioned this before, but when I look at this team, I'm like, wow, all these players are individually good, but they just don't work together very well.
I know the off-season move you're hoping for. GBM to Najin.
I think that'd be a great move.
So that
for
would
Najin.
Be Duke, GBM, and OQ as your threat.
I mean, honestly, moving Goong to Jhenair is probably good, too. Goong is on the top of the list in terms of kills, or near the top overall this season. So it's been a weird season for Jhenair, because they definitely have some very good pieces, but they don't play together in a fashion that is going to actually win them a lot of games.
All right, so let's say no roster moves. I think they just need to have one thing. Have Doa come in, get them to embrace the Bloodthirsty. Because they're just not. They don't pick up kills. Kill distribution's not lopsided. It's so even. It's so tassel. It's so passive. And they just really need that selfish damage there.
Right. And we thought maybe that would be Kuzan, but Kuzan's still very raw as a rookie player. So.
It may develop to that, but right now, certainly not the immediate answer.
Well, so far they're doing A-OK. They've actually farmed themselves to a pretty nice lead here. Sivir
going for a big walk.
Yeah, Sivir getting a little bit of a CS advantage already, and here comes GBM. He's just going to walk into the topside, not even bothering to use his ult. But great warding early from Jhenair. They're trying to control this top side. They want to shut Expecion down. So Trace actually will be doing some proxy farming, and IM wants to respond with that dragon. Now this is going to be Seed Scuttle Crab over to this Jhenair roster, but they don't. I think they're just going to give it up.
They don't really have the members on that side of the map really to impact it. So it's going to be an unanswered dragon coming through for IM. Remember, IM tried to get the lanes they wanted, force Gnar into a lane swap. Now, the moment that they swap back, he's getting punished. They're trying to build up Trace to really be in the position to body this Gnar and ensure they don't have a lopsided teleport battle later in the game.
Indeed. Well, GBM still has both those TPs up, especially now level 6, but with very little rage.
I mean, probably a lot of rage, but no Gnar bar, for sure.
No Gnar bar, indeed. So not much here so far besides Jhenair just building up a gold advantage through their farming. And Chaser be handing over that blue buff shortly. Frozen already with his, just collected alongside that dragon. But Jhin Air with deep wards on both sides of the map right now. Vision game definitely in favor of the Green Wings, but it's time. They need to make a move right now. They have a ton of kill pressure with this lineup. They need to make use of it early on.
We're always waiting for that first big Twisted Fate Destiny to work out, just how this Twisted Fate will impact the game. You know, when they get snowballing with the extra gold in your passive, you can certainly take over games. Of course, in the late game, we're going to have so much split push threat. I mean, of course, the Destiny's on a shorter cooldown than once before. We will see CDR come through with the CDR boots. But with the teleport, so many flexible options. And I guess one small question to ask you is that I can understand the teleport against the likes of Ezreal. Against the Victor, I still see some of the merit, because I remember how many games we've seen recently where specifically Faker picks up that enchant onto the E, clears waves, then always first to roam. You wouldn't think that would be relevant with Twisted Fate, but I guess just with his low base stats, now you can't just go for, say, an ultimate, chunk him out, and try and take down that tower early. Is it still the right choice against a Victor?
Well, the question becomes, too, do you need that ghost to avoid some of Victor's damage in team fights? Get away from the Death Ray, get away from the Chaos Storm. Just puts a premium on the TF positioning. If he can pull it off, then it'll look great, but it's one fewer tool. Here comes the dive, and here we go. There's the gold card coming in, Expression in that Meganar form, but there's just so much damage now that Sheen has been completed for GBM, and he's right back into the mid lane.
Has to teleport to the defensive target. There's three members of rotated to mid. Still has very strong wave here. Sweet's coming around as well.
They want to make this play. TP coming in from Trace. They can follow this up. Ignar low. There's the knockup right as Trace comes through. Gravity Field will get the stun. Ignar has to flash, and there is a gold card, and the wild card's not going to take Ignar out. But a great defensive move onto the turret there from Jhin Air, and now they're just going to back off.
60-odd health Janna lives on. It was a nice play, but teleport is expended, and teleport is available for Expression. Suddenly, remember, that was teleport onto a ward, so that's a 5-minute cooldown for Expression to play around.
Yeah, Ignar played that extremely well, by the way. He got the immediate knockup as soon as the port came through from the Howling Gale, so it was a great disengage from Ignar. Gravity Field going down to make sure that Trace could not make a play.
Ignar, in general, has been a revelation this season for IM. We mentioned he's one of the two players that's played every series. In general, just never really been, you know, one of the problems when they were losing, and has put in some excellent individual plays on the likes of Alistar.
Yeah, that is definitely true. I mean, that's why we see so many support bans targeted at IM, because he is a very real threat. So GBM is going to start farming up the jungle right now, moving towards that Lich Bane so he can power up those ganks. Destiny will be off cooldown shortly, and will that result in another play? Jhin Air doing a nice job with that gold lead. They got Trace the kill in the top side. That will be very helpful as he itemizes to prevent him from being pushed out of lane by this Gnar.
Honestly, he hasn't really itemized that way, Monte Cristo. He's gone for the Righteous Glory, which helps in the laning matchup, but it's certainly not a Glacial Shroud or True Armor, maybe the Frozen Heart. That's a teamfight item. You know, with the Nidalee, especially with the Nidalee farming up a Storm, 9 CS ahead of Gragas, they're looking for the flexibility to fight for this second dragon.
Yes, they are. So can they pull it off? Frozen starting to get some decent damage here down the turret.
Oh,
now Frozen gets tagged by a spear.
Bye-bye.
And that is going to be cleansed. Two sins there.
Okay.
Chaos Storm is popped. That's just going to chase Chaser away. Chaser going to pounce his way and heal up to safety. But that is it's a nice cooldown eliminated right there. Both summoners from Frozen expended to get himself out of that situation.
So which of those summoner expenditures, the teleport from Trace or both the defensive summoners from Frozen, will be more important in a minute's time?
And here comes Pilot. Tucson is looking for an aggressive play, and that's not going to work out, but a nice attempt there onto the red buff. They did have that TP, of course, but that will be matched by the Destiny from Twisted Fate. So Expression doesn't quite have that same freedom that he might normally have if he had a teleport advantage. And Trace's TP not looking like it's going to be up in time for the second dragon. So Jhin Air is going to have to make some tough decisions about where they want to go.
No big item time is completed by either mid lane, of course. You very much need those two Hexcore upgrades to be relevant, both in terms of the roam and the flexibility of having the movement speed for the Q Augment and just the wave clear from the E Augment. GBM cannot quite get the Lich Bane. Of course, spending 1,500 gold-ish on the boots just to be a global pressure. It's got them one kill so far, but it's only the single Destiny use in the first 15 minutes.
Yeah, that is true. And the other thing we haven't even mentioned is that, close. Is that with the TP, TF actually opens up some very interesting flank attacks just by using teleport like a top laner would to get into combat. TF is such an interesting champion, like you were saying, because his flexibility is fascinating.
Is it going to be the Lich Bane rush? Is it going to be the Zhonya's rush for teamfight? You get a lot of information from the summoners and the item choices. And just, you know, strategic decision-making and items for an AP champion. That's what, of course, Riot was going for with the Nidalee Large Rod being lower price on this patch, and at 1250 gold, I believe. Just with the flexibility of AP items churning around, Twisted Fate always had it. It's why he's one of the most unique champions to watch, is that he's got so many different playstyles that are viable.
Indeed he does. Well, we are going to see Janair start to set up right here. They knock down the topside turret in the interim. It's a very nice win there, actually, for Maokai, considering that is not normally the way we see this matchup play out. Typically, it's the Gnar chipping away very methodically. Bottom side, Pilot actually taking a lot of damage as the dragon is live. That could mean a Dragon 4 Incredible Miracle.
Worth noting that at no point was the Maokai on an island. He was always in a situation where Chaser was really pathing around him to ensure that this was the reality, and then was ganked for the kill. So, yeah. Of course, the death would have impacted things. Jhinnah has bought time for Tracer's teleport to come up. So credit to them. The 5-minute timer we talked about, can Expression take advantage of the 5-minute teleport timer? The answer, squarely, is no.
Yep. That is true. And now, just some vision control from Incredible Miracle. Trace wants to make a play here. Now, Gnar is trying to freeze the lane close to the tier two, but this can backfire because it gives your opponents a lot of time to actually play the map. And just kind of line up in some other lanes to take down tier ones. However, Trace will very confidently strut into the top side. Doesn't have that same ward coverage that he did earlier.
Speaking of ward coverage, two pinks around the dragon area. Even though Expression is just in that tired stage and there was a certain window where Jhinnah could look to try and force some pressure around dragon, they just haven't prepped the waves or the vision to realistically do so.
They haven't. So it looks like everybody just falling back right now. Nothing. I'm surprised no one really wants to make this play right here. They're going to make a play on topside. Instead, there's Expression, and the same gank happening again. Gold card will hit him after the bounce. There's the wild cards coming through, and that will be a kill for GBM as he locks in another card. And Expression targeted very heavily this game, and Jhinnah says, we're just going to give up the dragons for the gold right now. They get kills, they extend their gold lead, they get a tier 2 turret, and that puts them up by about another 1,000. And that comes at the price of two. Is anybody going to stop this? Hello, I am.
Gragas is the first one to start recalling.
Hello?
Victor does as well, but they're going to get a lot of damage. It's probably going to be the turret.
Well, this is confusing. You can't leave a Twisted Fate with a Sheen in a lane like that. And so they have an exposed inhibitor now at 17 minutes.
You can reason as you like about, you know, making the immediate gold versus delayed dragon choices, you know, establishing win condition. That all goes out the window when you take an inhibitor turret at 18 minutes. That must be the fastest inhibitor turret we've seen champions this season.
It's definitely close, I can say that. And the big threat here, when we talk about split pushing, why isn't split pushing good right now? Because it's so hard in a 1v1 scenario to take out that inhibitor turret. With that down, Twisted Fate is basically going to just have a perpetual backdoor onto your tower, and once he starts stacking AP and that Lich Bane gets more and more and more efficient, he has TP, he just TP to a ward at any time, walk up and kill the inhibitor. This is a disaster for Incredible Miracle.
And so let's talk about where this inhibitor tower is down. It's down in the top lane, so what does that mean? Enjoy your two dragons while you have them, IM, because getting any more is going to be impossible. You're going to have to really rotate members. Jhinnah can send two members top, the incredible damage and double CC combo. Speaking of CC, GBM needs to make some very fast feeder movements. They're going to lose the mid turret, but they can send two members top, and through the flexibility of Destiny and two summoner teleports, IM just don't have the resources to deal with them.
No, there's, I mean, basically if Jhin Air, like you're saying, if they play this out properly, it's almost impossible for them to lose. Well, Chaser gonna get knocked around, actually has to flash out of the Chaos Storm. Sweet there, pops the ultimate. He will live through this more than likely as he gets a little bit of a boost there. Sivir moving up with that on the hunt. More spears firing for the backside, but guess where GBM is? He's in the topside, used that Destiny. Expedition is dead to rights, twists in advance. GBM locks in the gold card, one last auto. Takes out Expedition for the third time. Expedition right there on your screen. He's suffering in the top side right now, heavily targeted, but you have to expect that. You see a TF Maokai in Nidalee, you know your life is gonna be hell. Meanwhile, TP from Trace is gonna arrive at the backside. TP from GBM actually coming through too. And now everybody on IM, I have to disengage, but there's so much crowd control. That is going to be the end of Tucson in that 5v4. Ignar being hunted right now. Clever little tornado there, and that will cause the javelin toss to just barely miss.
Disengage and re-engage from Jhin Air is squarely on point. This is the Jhin Air that in my mind fits the meta, and at least they're trying something different. Just the adaptation of the summoner has opened up so much pressure for Jhin Air.
Yeah, it's a great composition for sure. And this is the first time, as I said, in Korea we've seen the teleport TF this year, but something that, as I said, EDG certainly has been playing around with in China. And if you think this is scary, teleport TF against low wave clear mid laners is even scarier, because basically you have no way of controlling the Twisted Fate.
And the obvious answer to it is to try to dive the TF, but then of course just teleport back to lane. There's timings where that works, there's timings where it doesn't. Twisted Fate, just with the fact that he's a lane losing champion in general, he does have that flexibility to say, whatever, I'm going to take the teleport, and more often than not, this will mean that my turret will stay up longer, and the plays you can make, we've already seen them in 20 minutes here, they're just things that other champions don't, are not able to do.
Now, GBM is going to come up with a very large gold lead too, having most of the kills on the team, and his passive, I see a 7,000 gold lead here for Jhin Air, and they've got total control over the pace of this game with that inhibitor down. So this next dragon looks like this will be very unlikely or Incredible Miracle. And Jhin Air, they made choices this game. There's the Destiny, he's going in. Where is he? Oh, hello. No one's in the mid tier two turret to take this out.
So
everyone on the bottom
well.
Side. Very nice map play from Jhin Air.
Yeah, a lot of damage. Will they be able to take it down? We can't see the tower help, but it has to be low. Even with the shield goes down, Jhin Air can just walk away. They've got the objective, no need to fight.
I love the way Jhin Air is playing this game, Papa Smithy. They gave up the dragons intentionally, shut down the main tank on Incredible Miracle, and just took the tower gold. And now there you can get in a position. I wish more teams would do this. Give up an early dragon or two, play for the gold lead, come back at Dragon 3 and fight it with a massive item advantage. Take the game that way.
Let's temper our excitement at Jhin Air in terms of overall optimism about this team as, I say, a playoff that, remember, this is an extension of a comp they were already very good at, and IM. Few teams would swap quite as disproportionately poorly at top lane. Losing your inhibitor turret, that was definitely something that we will not see with any regularity.
Yes, no, that was, and also even that tier two turret, their lane assignments have been very poor this game, no doubt.
Jhin Air so fast to swap trinkets. We actually saw earlier Chaser had started the game with a warding totem, switched it to a sweeper to help with gank pressure, instantly into the upgraded warding totem. Four warding totems, well no, do you know why there's no four warding totems? Because that's the Captain Jack thing. Pilot sticks with the scrying orb, and that'll serve him just fine.
That's true, but again, as you're mentioning, Jhin Air, that team that likes to upgrade three or more early warding totems, and they basically say, here's how we want to play the game. We want to kite. We don't need to deny you any information because we're just going to stand at the objective. It doesn't matter if you see us, and we will see all your flanks coming in, and we will play the kite game.
But it goes further than that. They've got two teleports, one teleport home guard, very soon to be two teleport home guard. Now wards and smart spots is even more important because with that extra teleport from GBM, even more flank threat when you just have complete information of the whole map.
Yeah, and it's just impossible to sweep all those wards out that you are creating with the Sight Stone and then three or more warding totems. You see right here, Chaser is up 3,000 gold on Tucson. Look at his farm difference.
106 to 64, and I am getting the dragon low.
And here we go, Alistar engaged. There's a Sivir ult popped already. Righteous Glory used. It will be coming in from the flank. That is the Gnar looking for an opportunity. His rage is almost filled. They're going to go on to Tucson. They're trying to attack the flank right now. Pilot and Chaser are stuck in the pit, though. Tucson getting very low. GBM wants a gold card target. He's not going to get it. And Dragon will reset back in the pit. Avnar gets in from behind, and he's going to pop the members of Jin Air back in with the Monsoon, but GBM finds him on the outside. One for one trade, support for support. Going down so far, especially gets an ult, but it's only onto the Maokai. That is not who you want. GBM is out of mana. He's going to have to Zhonya's through the Hourglass, and this is going to be IM actually winning this fight. Jin Air taking a lot of dragon damage inside the pit. They were split up and just poked to death by Incredible Miracle. Very poorly fought.
To say they were split up, Monte Cristo, is an amazing underestimation. Pilot sat in the back of the Dragon Pit for 25 seconds, auto-attacking nothing. He was zoned the whole fight. Finally, Chaser could turn into the Cougar form and hop over. But this whole team fight, Pilot did precisely nothing the moment he kited down towards the Dragon.
Yeah, they were at a split call here. They didn't know what they want to do. Three members go in, two
Watch
members.
Pilot. In the back line, the two of them and Chaser just trying to work out, is there a re-engage option? Sweet's ultimate runs out. Tracer's ultimate, remember the duration is finite. It runs out. Pilot is still doing nothing, just throwing out the Q. He's not able to do anything, doesn't have flash or isn't willing to use it. They eventually re-engage it as Expression. One man onto the Maokai, but it's not because Pilot could not contribute anything, and Frozen was very smart in holding his cooldown.
Yes, he was. Well, very questionable team fight from Jin Air. And they have to get together. I mean, if they want to kite, they need to be together on these calls. GBM going to come in. Tornado not going to knock him up as the Destiny comes through. And Ignar will fall to Pilot's Boomerang Blade. A lot used, but they are just going to push into the top side right now. Another thing, Jin Air absolutely could have just been pushing down that top lane inhibitor during that time, too. They committed to that fight, then misplayed it.
Teleports weren't up on Trace and GBM. That's why they didn't go for it. Teleport for Trace about 40 seconds away as we started that fight. It was very awkward in general, but I mean, the map rotation macro calls from Jin Air have been wonderful, but that team fight obviously lacked clear calling because the two threats, specifically Chaser and Pilot, just didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
And if someone had just called Pilot and said, flash over the back of the pit, re-engage with the tank line, things would have gone very differently.
You're absolutely right. He could have flashed over because Trace and the rest of Jin Air fell down into that tri-brush, so it would have been quite easy.
Chaser was able to hop over. The flash was available, but not used by Pilot. So you have to assume that's just poor shot calling overall because the map movement, we've seen very smart moves, and they now have 6 turrets to 1. They're playing the turret game well. Maybe it's time to stick with that and just opt out of these team fights.
Yeah, opt into the inhibitor. Easy way to win the game.
Oh, that sounds pretty good. If I could just opt into an inhibitor, that I'd win most of my games.
Hey, well, Jin Air, they can do that. They have that power here.
Is this going to be one of those series where there's a naked inhibitor and no one tries to take it down for 25 minutes?
We really hope not, Papa Smitty. We really hope not.
Because, I mean, there is a win condition open for IM. 3 dragons down by about 25 minutes. So we're talking about 36, 37, 38 minutes for the 5th dragon. Jin Air have already shown their teamfight shot calling shaky. They need to establish some sort of win condition. Taking down this top lane inhibitor, that means it's very, very difficult to opt into fights around dragons. What we talked about earlier. Still haven't seen the natural extension of taking that objective.
Well, here we go. TP coming in. They want to do a Baron right now. Risky call from Jin Air.
No
will they turn
on
this?
Expression.
Yep, no TP on Expression. He's in the bottom side right now, so they're burning it down. Trace tanking out most of the damage right now. Not too much damage dealt from the Baron. Tucson will be knocked up on the outside, and that's a Smite secure. IM not able to fight and not willing to commit to that because they didn't have their top laner. So again, Jin Air playing with their mobility on the map, and IM making further poor decisions.
I mean, the map movement, that's been Jin Air's purview, and it was the map lane rotation or lane assignment that we talked about for Jin Air. That was the big problem for IM. Why was Expression on the diametrically opposite side of the map with no teleport? The damage is still very real from Jin Air. They even have damage coming out from the jungler. Maokai has relevant damage with the Twisted Advance onto a big neutral like the Baron. Effectively free Baron through to Jin Air.
Free Baron, free inhibitor turrets, tons of free objectives for Jin Air this game. Just
very charitable.
Yeah, very charitable I am. It's very nice of you. I'm sure Jin Air appreciates it as they look to secure some sort of playoff seed and keep their hopes for the season and keep their hopes for
the world championship alive. Legendary was in the playoffs last season. They do have, you know, some decent circuit points. They ended in fourth place.
Something we didn't mention is that Chaser chose the stacking build for the Jungle Diddly. About 21 minutes was his Rod of Ages timing, so about 31 minutes. It's a very late Rod of Ages by top lane standards, but it will allow him to scrap a bit more in the Cougar range form. So that could be very useful for him. Didn't opt for the Tia, so it's a different type of stacking from the Nidalee. It feels like they so naturally go through those Tia stacks in a non-mana fashion that Tia's always the go, but with that extra health, just that much more relevant in the front line.
Well, too, the AP buffs on the patch to Rod of Ages makes it a more attractive item in terms of damage output.
Didn't even consider that. Good point. 5.13 Rod of Ages, definitely shifting the power towards ability power overall.
So here we go. GBM, Baron buff, TF split push on the bottom side.
No teleport still.
No teleport still. He does have that destiny, but he can't actually get to his team very quickly. Remember, he doesn't have Ghost, so split pushing cross map on TF like this is more dangerous because you can't get into range for your ultimate quite as fast.
Doesn't feel like IM have any true initiation, though. We're talking about some sort of wombo between Gragas and Nahu, who often have more negative synergy than positive synergy. And without Expression having that summoner teleport to answer the two, you know, the plethora of options they have in terms of split pushing Dejanire, they're just going to inevitably lose these free objectives that they've been donating most of this game.
And with that dragon up in 10 seconds, Jhenair has that on lockdown. They're waiting in the enemy jungle right now, seeing if they can maybe get a pick. Tucson has to walk very far forward to actually get some wards down into the river, but I don't know if there's any way that IM can really contest this. They're not even going to try.
This is finally the reward for all the map pressure that was exerted specifically early on to Expression, who's been so well held by Jhenair's map rotations. The immediate goal to answer the stacking mechanic, if you finally get to this point where Tucson comes towards the dragon, only has one defensive ward anywhere near the buff, you will eventually monopolize control and remove the threat of the fifth dragon, which honestly is the only thing really keeping IM with any level of optimism in this game.
That's right. So, will we see this inhibitor eventually go down? It has been naked for about 13 minutes right now. They've tried to...
Have you no shame, inhibitor?
Have you no shame? Inhibitor strumpet, strutting around naked.
Wanton. Wanton. To be fair to Jhenair, though, these guys are gentlemen. They don't visit the naked inhibitor. They stay well away.
Go for the naked dragon instead.
You know how I knew they were gentlemen? It's the bow tie. Let's be real.
It's the GBM bow tie coming through.
He's just not visiting the naked inhibitor. It's been there a long time, Monty. It's advertising. We've already called it wanton, but all on its own. I am appreciate that because it gave them that window to work towards the dragons, but unfortunately, losing all your outer turrets, that's not even a realistic win condition now. So Jhenair really feel like they need to pull the finger out and actually just force something. But the last time they forced, they lost a big team fight.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if they need to force. I think, again, they can just very comfortably split push in this game. But GBM has not really been in the top side at all. We are going to see Chaser. He's got a big buy coming through. Zhonya's Hourglass will be the pickup. So double Zhonya's now on the side of the Jhenair Green Wings.
If there's ever any confusion about who the true carry of this Jhenair lineup, it's the Rod of Ages, Zhonya's Hourglass jungler. I'm the carry, guys.
Too true.
Just give me time.
Just give me time. I will split push. I will burst them down. I will land my spears.
This needs to be a little bit less of a one-man army, does this Jhenair lineup, but maybe there's another week or an off-season to really boost that possibility.
Here we go, Jhenair. Looking at this bottom side once again, GBM apparently doesn't want to actually split push into the top where he could quickly dispose of that inhibitor with his massive amount of AP coupled with his Lichbane.
15 minutes with no clothes on this inhibitor. Still well, no one going anywhere near it.
And this is, we look at this game and we can say, wow, Jhenair really did a good job of giving IM the runaround, getting all these towers, getting this gold lead, but where is the closure? Because this is where Jhenair starts to take their foot off the pedal usually, give their opponents an opportunity to get to six items, and then crush them in a team fight.
We've seen this, I believe it was against CJ. Finally, we see some initiation,
holy
but it's from
cow.
IM, and popped is the Sivir. Enough ability power onto the likes of a Victor, and this can happen.
So dangerous to be in that situation because that Gragas Victor actually does have a lot of synergy because of the burst coming in. Violet just had no chance right there whatsoever.
You could be Captain Jack with the spell shield mechanics and you were still dead that time.
Yeah, 100%. So, even though the wards were there for Jyn Eyre and Violet felt comfortable coming up, he did not appreciate the Gragas ultimate threat that would get him into range. Now I am. They want to push forward right now. 40 seconds until the next Baron.
I'm getting worried. I think panic station's not necessarily required from Jyn Eyre, but the fact that this inhibitor without a turret hasn't, they haven't rotated around it. How could they be so smart with their lane rotations and assignments earlier and then just fail so spectacularly?
The Jyn Eyre conundrum. So, looking for another Baron, quite possibly. Waves are pushed very heavily in favor of Jyn Eyre. Looks like Gnar on the bottom side, but with teleport.
Yep.
This time around.
This time, the strategic hole has been closed by M. So credit to them for that. The item timings, honestly, the Victor in particular is very fearsome in terms of items. Jyn Eyre really need to guarantee this Baron with a pick, or otherwise. In a game where inhibitor fell at 18 minutes, that's the potential for a 50-50 fight 20 minutes later.
Yeah, really don't want that. Gnar actually popped his talisman during that ward clear. So that is a tool that will not be available to IM for a little while. GBM may be answering the push here onto the bottom side. Two TPs available for the Jyn Eyre Green Wings right now.
And to back away when Pilot was popped, now they can go back to the split push play, make sure that someone is paying if we do see a Baron contest. And honestly, if at minimum Jyn Eyre can't force, say, an inhibitor swap for a Baron contest, they've made a mistake.
Yeah, absolutely. And here we go. GBM could be in the top side right now, pushing that wave forward. He has the vision to make sure that he's not going to be isolated while the rest of his team does Baron. They can actually successfully threaten both objectives at the same time right now, but for some reason, GBM is still in that bottom lane.
Still a gentleman, forever the gentleman. No backdooring allowed, Monte Cristo. You can't go to the top lane. You have to work your way slowly. Take out all those. Didn't you know that they changed 5.13? You got to take all the outer inhibitor turrets out before you can actually push forward.
I see.
It was a hidden note.
It wasn't actually a documented change.
No, undocumented.
Someone told Jyn Eyre, though, so they're on top of it.
Chivalrous to the end. I'm getting sad now, Monte Cristo.
I don't know why Maokai is in the bottom side either.
Honestly, send both of them to one lane, the top lane, if you want to go for this. But why are they both on the bottom side of the map? It beggars belief.
I don't know what they're doing. This is how you get no objectives in a game.
I don't think this game really deserves any more strategic talks. Let's talk about something else. How's life, Monte?
Till somebody actually does something here.
I mean, I am. They're doing fine. Yeah. But don't know what Jyn Eyre are doing. The cricket's not going so well, but Australia did beat England in the second Ashes test.
I don't know what that means.
It's 1-1, you understand that. It's equal at the moment.
I see.
Australia, the previous champions.
How are your bowlers?
They bowl well. The batters have been thwacking the ball and running between the wickets.
Ah, yes, the wickets.
Yes, the wickets. The game ends at stumps on day 1, 2, 3, and 4.
All right, well, Dragon is up, and this is good. What is happening right now? Looks like, is there actually a Baron being taken? No, it was an absolutely free Dragon.
So back to cricket talk.
I don't even know what's happening in this game.
I don't think Jyn Eyre do either, because they're certainly not playing it.
Okay, TP, up to the Baron. Jyn Eyre decides to do Baron right now. They see Victor at the bottom side jungle, so Jyn Eyre should be able to get this one if they don't get it. Smite stolen by Tucson. GBM there as well, two TPs used. They are going to secure the Baron, and will they turn afterwards? Sweet's already with his ultimate pop, and they are going to have to disengage. Expression coming in. Pilot wants to get some damage down. They're trying to kite back into the choke point right now. Chaser going to be over the wall. Sweet will lose his life in exchange for the Baron. Frozen there late. Does not have a chance to get his ultimate or his damage down, but that was two TPs used by the Jyn Eyre Green Wings to secure that objective.
They still do have the ultimate. The Destiny is available. They really prepped the waves well, finally, maybe 20 minutes later than they should have. So they had to back away IM. They couldn't chase further, only picked up the one kill, only denying the one Baron, and unfortunately not from one of the split pushes. Okay, 3 minutes of huge power for a split push team. Lane assignments. Where do they need to go to win this game, Monte Cristo? What are the lane assignments that would be optimal? Because it feels like we've been talking about them, we've been shaking our heads. GBM's back in the bot lane, so is that already thrown out the window? Or can we finally have Maokai now with Baron buff minions go to the top lane?
I just don't agree with the split from the Twisted Fate here.
He's been banned from the top side, let's be real. He hasn't seen a top side lane since what? His ganks earlier in the game.
Yeah, what I would do is I would put TF top and I would put four mid, so you actually cover the ultimate. If you split in the side lanes right now, you're still running that risk that GBM cannot get there in time for a team fight. Should Jhin'Erh be engaged on?
And he needs to be instantly in the back line on top of the Kog'Maw. He is not in range of that till he's really walking towards the mid lane.
Yeah, well, Sweet the one without the Baron buff right now. There is no mid minion pressure in the mid lane. Trace is here in the top side. Everyone else from Jhin'Erh, they want to go after this inhibitor.
Maybe with the opposite lane assignments than we expected, but it's time to take down this inhibitor. They took it down at 18 minutes, the inhibitor turret. 22 minutes later, haven't found a way to pick it up despite having a Baron subsequently. Now the second Baron, at minimum, this inhibitor must fall.
I feel like I'm going crazy, Papa Smithy.
Well, we were talking about cricket for a good 3 minutes there, so as an American, you probably have.
All right, well, the inhibitor has been opened up on the bottom side of the map right now, so Baron minions, there's that Lich Bane TF slowly doing work here, trying to deal with Expression. Expression does block a pick a card with his Banshee's Veil. Finally, Jhin'Erh may get this in. Okay, Victor on the bottom side, that is a kill pressure threat onto GBM. He could 100-0 him if GBM misplays it.
Frozen walking quickly, use the Q. Lane assignments aren't ideal. No teleport from Expressions. It's smart of him to be around the other members and has some decent wave here, but at minimum, yeah, this
okay.
is going
to
be.
I got excited.
One more. There we go.
Cannon minion breaks the deadlock.
The 23-minute stalemate after taking down the inhibitor.
This is a huge minion wave in the mid lane, too, but that will be quickly cleaned up by Chaser, who recalls back to base. GBM still needs to get out of dodge here. Can't really 1v1 with the rest of his team back at base trying to get these minion waves.
So the thing to understand if you're, say, you know, Jhin'Erh's next opponent's watching the tape is that this exact strategy 20 minutes ago would have been super, super effective. They would have got much more because remember, even if Expression had teleport, he was the one who was far behind. He had no items 20 minutes ago. Casually has farmed up the likes of Aranduins and Banshee Veil since they were last in this situation with a naked inhibitor and the Baron buff riding down on Jhin'Erh. The pick on pilot has bought them so much time that now Expression's relevant, but here comes the potential pick.
And GBM coming in with that gate. Tucson in the front lines has a very bad ultimate. Is he going to go down? Looks like no, the disengage coming through, and that'll be enough to keep them alive at the moment. Only this one turret left. Jhin'Erh starts to make go to the bottom side. Jhin'Erh.
Now they got to siege down this turret, Monte Cristo. That's the rule, apparently.
This is unbelievable. Well, I guess we're going to face tank the turret and take out the last inhib turret. Oh, GBM getting low, gets tagged, gets slowed, 50% HP.
Expression still exhausted, didn't build up any rage despite chunking out GBM, and yeah, no objectives. No objectives allowed. Okay, so we were talking about cricket. Is the next step silence? Is it a minute's silence for the Jhin'Erh fans?
I am just struck by disbelief. This game should have been over 15 minutes ago. But Jhin'Erh has spent so much time diddling around the map that IM is now in a position where they can win one team fight and actually win this game in spite of this insane goal deficit that they have.
I can tell how disappointed you are by your use of the word diddling. That's not a Monte Cristoism right there. Sansa casually found up a lot of items. 30 seconds till the fifth dragon. It's insane that we're talking about fifth dragon pressure from a team that has had a 25-minute naked inhibitor. An inhibitor's down, the super minions are pushing into top. This is where IM's sometimes poor strategic decisions might really be put to the sword by Jhin'Erh.
I'll see if Jhin'Erh can actually team fight well, unlike the last time they had an attempt at this dragon. Right now, GBM's on the flank. He's looking. for a TP. He's going to TP up. Here comes Epic backdoor. He's going to go for the win right now. Expression has to TP back. But remember, GBM can just gate right back into this one. It's going to be a 50-50. And Chaser with a steal saves Jenner's bacon in a lot of ways. GBM now going to be coming back with the gate into the team fight. Double kill for Chaser, triple kill for Chaser, and here we go. That is going to be a Maokai kill onto the Kog'Maw. Chaser running away from that Ekathian surprise. Wow, Jhinnair really playing with fire right there. That was bold and partially crazy to make that play.
But was it that crazy when, of course, Twisted Fate has two globals, and in this case, both of them were semi-global enough to be relevant in the fight? They ran Expression around. They finally used what they had tried to cultivate 25 minutes previously. And okay, it's delayed, but Jhinnair finally, with their massive early advantage, parlay that into a win.
Here we go. Dex is going to go down. Jhinnair wins game one in nearly 45 minutes. Some very interesting map play that game.
Interesting.
Yeah. Well, it was half brilliant, right? Because Jhinnair started playing the turret game extremely well.
But what's the other side of the half brilliance, Monte Cristo?
Half crazy. Jhinnair, crazy like a fox.
Yep. Formerly Real Foxy, now Chaser. That's another great performance on Nidalee. There's a reason this champion must be banned. We're looking at damage dealt to champions. It isn't any surprise that Chaser's right up the top.
Yeah, Chaser. Right at the top, he was about, what, 5k ahead of the enemy jungler in this game. Tucson, no, he's, oh, excuse me, he was 7,000 gold ahead of Tucson.
Can we visually just, what's 7,000 gold? That's a Trinity Force and an IE, yeah. Almost both of them?
That's crazy. Well, it's been a weird one. Jhinnair does take the win. Good comp. All right, so game number two, new jungler, Spooky.
No, that's his name.
Yep, I know. That game is not haunted.
Bit of things coming on the studio that makes it look a bit spooky at this present point, but we don't know much
the
about
fog
this player.
Machines.
Just adding to the effect.
The darkness. It's a perfect environment for Spooky.
Is it Nocturne first pick time? It could be a Nocturne flex pick. I talked about this last time on air. Chaoi loves it in the mid lane.
Geez.
Look, why can't you believe the oldest counter pick in the book to Twisted Fate mid was Nocturne mid?
That's actually true.
Think about it.
For those of you who are not watching, way back in the day, in Season 3, Blaze and Frost, the CJ teams, really did like to counter pick that. It was quite odd. And the TF, smart ban. Smart ban, I feel.
But is it smart to leave up the Nidalee and also to ban away the Annie? Because they've banned away backline initiation. And okay, Twisted Fate out, that's one headache they don't have to deal with. But Chaser's Nidalee needs no introduction. Hell, we saw it last game.
And with this, what is IM going to do? They could take that Alistar for Ignar. That is a champion that he has been very successful on. But the Victor available, probably going to be grabbed by Jhinnair very early in this draft without the TF or the pick. And
the
Kog'Maw.
Oh, God. Kog'Maw Maokai is a fearsome red side first set of picks, but by itself, opening up, say, Maokai Nidalee for the excellent gank top, excellent synergy between those two champions. Look, Jhinnair can't run quite the same comp, but they could put together a decent impersonation of it.
Yeah, and Alistar Maokai, another possible combination. Alistar Victor, I mean, there are just so many tools you have right now if you're Jhinnair, and many of these picks are hard engage picks to help you deal with the Kog'Maw. Runeglaive Ezreal still certainly on the board here, and they could take away the Gnar. That is a champion we've seen banned against Expression, actually.
So Expression have played six unique champions, now finally played the Gnar for the second time. After the first performance, 3-1 and 10, he was at a 13 KDA. Obviously chopped down a bit in the previous years. Very weird to not see Maokai taken when it's available, given that Trace, despite the team's mixed fortunes, is 7-1 on that champion after last game.
So, prioritizing that Gnar. I don't know if you do that in this particular situation. They're also going to take the Gragas, which has slipped through the draft. So Chaser mixing up his jungler with something that's a little bit more reliable, I would say, even if it does have less carry potential for him.
I mean, why take the risk? You see a Kog'Maw. We've seen Kog'Maw win a lot, I believe about 72% win rate overall after the loss in the last game, because there's so little backline pressure. Cinderhawk top laners are gone. Only the likes of Maokai give you the targeted backline from the top lane that's really in the meta. And now you take Gnar Gragas, which can have as much teamfight synergy as teamfight anti-synergy when we're talking about the big repositioning ultimates, the Gnar and the Explosive Cast.
That's right. So probably going to be a Rek'Sai here. Why wouldn't you take the Alistar? Alistar actually falling very far down the draft because there were a lot of pocket bans in this draft. The Azir, the Evelynn, the Twisted Fate. So trying to target out some of these players.
Lister's still a permaban despite quite a heavy set of changes sent her way. We talked a bit about the potential for the Runeglaive of Ezreal. So Pilot also, it's a caster AD carry, but of course you never really want to opt straight into the AD carry as we kind of default to it, and with last pick, that certainly looms as an option for this Gen Air lineup. Just waiting to see where they want to go with their comp, because with the Gragas Gnar duo, they have a lot of options.
Right, and here's the thing, if they do pick the option of having the Ezreal here, it may prompt IM to take the Maokai, in which case you have that preferable lane matchup.
Okay.
And I think maybe they will grab the Braum here.
And the correct play is not to lock in your mid laner. Even though
yes.
Victor looms as a really top meta pick, I think you just shroud it all in secrecy.
Yep, absolutely.
And when you've got the ranged auto attackers, the likes of Gnar and Ezreal, to proc that Braum passive, even if it is the mid lane or the bot lane Ezreal, I think we're in good stead so far with this Gen Air draft.
Yes. Yes, I think we are. Lots of disengage, a lot of disruption and kiteability for Gen Air. IM has to pick some more hard engage right now. They probably need to pick the Maokai, but that's going to put them in a situation where you actually have a losing top lane matchup against that Gnar. So Gen Air forcing some tough decisions from Incredible Miracle.
It is a top lane matchup that you can navigate around. We saw just the last game, of course, being navigated around. And then, of course, back on Saturday, we saw a solo kill from Maokai against
okay,
Gnar.
Okay, those are outliers. Remember the camp last game? It takes a lot.
The recency effect is in full display. I've seen two games. Maokai's won them both. Maokai's a Gnar counter. Don't you know, Monte Cristo?
Juggernaut may be coming through.
No engage, so why not?
Yeah, they can at least match poke for poke here. Oh, Cassiopeia instead switched up at the last second. So apparently Frozen very comfortable with blind picking that champion.
And Cassiopeia doesn't necessarily mean this is not a Juggernaut comp. Okay, maybe it's not a true Juggernaut comp, but it's still Cassiopeia does provide great peel with the petrifying gaze for a Kog'Maw. So Kog'Maw is relatively free in the backline. Okay, Gnar and Gragas have potential, but it's not reliable engage onto this Kog'Maw.
No, certainly is not. They basically have to hope for some very good Gragas casks, and they're going to have an AD carry with probably a tier early on for Pilot, so may have some trouble up against Kog'Maw should they get those standard lanes. GBM, a lot of burden on him. Now, we've seen GBM step up and make flank plays on Victor to engage when Gen Air has had low amounts of primary engage in the past. He can be tricky on that champion. He's found ways into the back line, but is that reliable? Gotta say, probably not, especially with the Tremor Sense on the other team.
I liked how you talked about the tier Ezreal. I feel like really delayed Bang and SKT's ability to really pressure anything against KT game one yesterday. I think you go the kid school of thought, just rush that Trinity Force outright, or maybe even just go for Blade the Ruined King. Get instant power of some description, because if you opt into Tia, the downside for your team, if anything goes wrong in the early game, is severe.
Yeah, I totally agree with you on that point. You just can't fight well enough in the laning phase to make it worth losing some turrets and having that big power trough where you can't fight around the dragon. Well, we'll see what Pilot builds. Game two, Gen Air Green Wings versus Longzhu IM right now. So, match point for Gen Air. Spooky starts his career by forgetting his trinket and items.
Ooh. Crowd rubs it in as well. Even loses the speed boost, of course, leaving the base. Doesn't refresh, so it's going to be much later. And now, because Gen Air's on a four-man, now five-man invade mission, that was a really decisive flash from Expecial.
Yeah, I'm not sure that was necessary, but he did want to stay out of range of the Winter's Bite. This could have locked him down. He didn't have any help on that top side. Certainly having the tremor sense would have been probably pretty useful right there. So deep wards going in. And no trinket or items for Chaser either.
Wow.
What is going on?
Something weird's going on in the jungle, Monte Cristo. I'm not even talking about the map movements.
Chaser's still asleep. Wow, that was, it was hilarious because he went down to put his ward. He's like, oh.
Smart cost bug?
Crap.
No smart cost bug, Chaser. You're just silly. Hard to say. Wow. Hard to say whether he's had to itemize, had to skill body slam for the CC effect or just to get to the jungle faster.
Well, this is awkward. I feel that after last game, it's just only appropriate that this game would start that way. Well, they could have put down some early pressure right there. They could have started by trying to take away the buffs in the jungle like we've seen. That's typically the warding pattern that you go when you're going to be doing that first buff invade, especially when you have the lane swap. And instead, we are going to see no pressure onto Spooky. But I think that invading early on, making Spooky make some tough pro game only decisions would have been a great way to start, but that is not what Jhin'Air is going to get, and probably going to be tier in this lane swap, considering Pilot will have a bit more time to farm up all by his lonesome.
We can only speculate that Chaser would be taking a page out of the likes of Score's playbook. Remember when he was against Catch earlier, against Spenu, really getting in his face and just trying to hold down a jungle that honestly he probably thought was inferior to him, and most junglers are inferior to Chaser, certainly on the big stage for the first time. This is the time when you try and boss around, but both junglers caught with the pants down at level one.
I love how at least Spooky realized it immediately, but Chaser actually went to ward before he figured out what the hell was going on.
I mean, to his credit, at least he was there proactively. They blew a flash because of his presence, and also, it's not like the machete provides any combat stats at level one, but yes, when it came to the warding, very awkward.
Okay, so we have a heavy stack up here. We don't normally see 3-minute ganks or this kind of lane swapping in Korea. Ignar is going to be there in the nick of time. And there's going to be a flash commitment. There's the Winter's Bite. They're going to try and get the stun. And there's the stack. Can they get the last auto? They do. Expression low. Expression no flash, remember.
Oh.
There's the commitment. E forward. Pilot gets the kill. Arcane shift and the last auto attack. Expression. I feel so bad for this guy tonight. He is just getting the
tar beat down.
He's just getting camped, though. It's not like he's necessarily playing poorly. He's been dove multiple times.
I mean, in this particular situation, no flash, 100% information to Jhin'Air. It was a very smart map rotation from Jhin'Air and movement around the map, but I agree. He's been so well held down. And remember, Jhin'Air initiated a lane swap despite having the Gnar versus Maokai mismatch because you just have to navigate Ezreal away from 2v2s early. He doesn't have the laning power in the AD carry role to hang with close to anyone. Maybe just Twitch, for example.
Yeah, especially with this itemization, but that will be an early tier for Pilot, and it looks like with that tier, they're moving into the 2v2.
Hmm.
I don't know about this either. Certainly, Trace is going to have an advantage. He does have a level edge right now.
Item advantage also. He's got the longsword. So it was this big struggle for Trace in this when he was opting into the Gnar versus Maokai matchup last time out. When he got solo killed by the Maokai, so a bit of war stories, a bit of PTSD perhaps for the Gnar, is that his first item buy after being held down was a non-magic mantle. At least this time, potions and the longsword means that he can just go harass happy against the Maokai.
Yeah, he can. Also, that early back from Pilot means that he's actually going to have a tier to just the Doran's blade, so he will actually be doing okay in this lane. So maybe bought himself a little bit of time. We'll see what Songstar manages to get on his first recall. He won't have that first blood gold like Pilot does.
Almost without fail, we see two starting lines. Oh my goodness, it's Chaser's caught Spooky. That's 2v2 action in the jungle.
That's right, and here comes Frozen. Ignar here, he's going to headbutt Chaser out. Chaser will go down. Was a 3v2, and GBM just not responding to the mid lane. Where's the gravity field? It will fall. Spooky gets stunned. Not enough follow-up damage, though, as Chaser gets caught out in that mid lane. You have to be careful walking into that river. Frozen did have the priority. GBM could not get over there faster than this Cassiopeia.
It was a really nice collapse by Ignat, but because he failed his headbutt pulverize and actually headbutted him out of vision, they lost damage. They had to overextend a bit more to get the kill onto Chaser. Maybe it would have been two clean kills, but the end result is still positive for IM as they have a lot of control around the bottom lane. Okay, Pilot has the mana regen and mana sustain, and he's building up towards an earlier timer for the Muramana, but the tier doesn't give him any combat stats, and this is already a losing matchup for Ezreal.
It's going to be quite tough to deal with this situation now. He's starting to fall pretty heavily behind in terms of CS. He'll catch up, of course, with this massive minion wave that's been building. Trace, on the other hand, starting to really take it to expression. He is two levels up on the Maokai right now. That is pretty intense. Expression just can't even get anywhere close to the minion wave.
And because it's already a naturally losing lane matchup, I think, honestly, it's probably Spooky's best idea to stay away and just say Expression, do the best that you can. As his teleport up again soon, so maybe we'll finally be able to make a decisive item purchase, but this is how this lane matchup should go. This should be Gnar just having his way with Expression, and the kind of the reason why this matchup doesn't get a lot better is that Expression, there's not really a lot of good itemization against a Gnar, because you might think, okay, pick up the armor to lessen the Q and auto-attack harass. A lot of the trade damage, when we're talking about levels 10 and 12, is going to be the W coming through from Gnar that does that magic damage, and you're going to always eat free auto attacks in a range versus melee matchup.
Yeah, there's really no avoiding that. And so a little bit of a tough time here for Expression. And actually, Pilot catching right back up in terms of creep score, managing to use that early back that he had to stay in lane, considering he was already starting to stack his tier. He also got a very early tier this game because of the first Blood Gold.
Yeah, it might be as early as maybe the pre-nerf tier days when we were talking about, what, 13 to 15 minute Muramana. It's probably not quite that early.
No. It's
still going to be pushing it, though, pre-20 minutes.
Yeah, 18 would be my estimate. We will see what happens with that item here. And
good old Jace being super-powered with a...
Those were the days.
Yeah. Jace still back, but even Coco couldn't really make it work. Okay, it was with the sub-goon crew, but one Jace game, no victories so far in Champions.
No, I think we'll see maybe some more Jace at some point, but a lot of the Varus and Jace play just hasn't really been popular in Korea recently.
Operation Smash in the face at the top side of the jungle when you have Maokai so far down into a rookie jungle is enacted by Chaser and the duo that's running through the jungle. Spooky's reacting as well. Does have the Raptor Sense buffs, are able to clear. This is not a 3v3 that LZIM wants to opt into.
No, it is not. Now they're going to start threatening. There's the True Shot Barrage, and that means GBM gets the blue buff and the kill onto Spooky. Trace manages to make his way into that topside jungle, and that was risky. They didn't know exactly what was going on there, because Chaser and GBM were staying quite still in the fog of war.
It was risky to a fault. Chaser and Sweet had already had time. So Chaser and the duo had already had time to prop up wards, get the extra vision. They had exact time as they, of course, had the vision both on the brush right behind the mid lane tower and also around the blue buff. So they used that to their advantage. Even had time for Pilot to prep the True Shot Barrage.
So that was actually very nicely done, the
absolutely.
True Shot Barrage.
That was good Jhin Air communication. That's what we were looking for maybe last game and saw in fleets and spurts.
Yeah, you don't expect that if you're Spooky to come in and try and take that objective. And it got actually the blue buff down within death ray range for GBM, so the timing really couldn't have been better.
GBM frozen, we're waiting to see the itemization. Spooky comes on Jimmy. He does use the Chilling Smite, does force the flash. It's still a successful gank, despite not having a flash to expend for the flash unbar. Remember on this patch, slightly smaller width for the unburrow from 200 to 160, but in terms of visual representation, just need to be that much more on form with the flash.
Yeah, I don't know about that change onto Rek'Sai either, because I think you need to change your auto attack range at that point too, because now you're getting into some weird situations where she'll be in auto attack range and she'll pop up, but she won't actually get the knockup down.
From what I was reading, her auto attack range is actually increased in that particular interaction, so I don't think it actually changes it too much. It's not that really weird interaction with how this goes, but it's something they've definitely been considering.
Yeah. Well, Trace back to the top side has that completed Hex Drinker right now.
Frozen has an Nidus Large Rod, but we're on 5.13, so it could still be Rylai's, which now builds out of the Nidus Large Rod.
Yeah. I assume we're going to be seeing something like that. Sweet ults in the bottom side.
No, didn't seem that good. It was an average ult to me.
And not even that good. Not even average, really.
Mediocre ult by Sweet.
We don't pick it up. The frozen with a flash. Petrifying Gaze. There's a knockup coming in from Spooky. And the disengage from Chaser gets the explosive cast down. There is a teleport coming in. They're still chasing onto Chaser. Trace is here. He's in Meganar form. Can he get the ult? He does. Three-man ultimate. Huge ult from Trace. GBM on the outside. His exhaust is worn off. Zonstar is dead, dead, dead. And Trace will get the kill onto Ignar. Double kill from Pilot. 4-0. Oh boy,
and
man.
You are so just frustrated if you're frozen because the CC layering at the start was good, but Ignar never got into headbutt pulver range. Just awkwardly walked slowly as the cab could not impact that fight. If there was triple wombo of CC, there would have been kills for IM.
Well, Spooky here, he wants to smite it. Not going to get the steal. But wow, I mean, just the play there from Jhin'Air to set that fight up. But look how much was burned just onto Chaser.
If the headbutt pulv comes in, Monte Cristo, I think they take down at least one of the members, minimum Chaser. But now they started chasing, and unfortunately the collapse was there. No teleport away from the map. A lovely Gnar ultimate into the wall. And the cleanup crew was true.
Yeah, it was. Trace going to get the kill on Ignar at the end too. Frozen, but that's a risk. You use your flash and your ultimate like that onto just a single target when the enemy TP is available, and you can get into a really sticky situation.
Ignar used his flash, didn't get into headbutt pulver range, didn't even have the ultimate to walk around and feel a bit sheepish in this particular situation, because it wouldn't have made a big impact. But I am so close, but so far.
Yeah, well, that's going to dig them into a rather significant hole, give up the first dragon, give up 4 kills, and that powered up pretty much every lane, and now this blue build Ezreal, he's not gonna have really a big problem.
No, now you can't force him out. Has such a high flat mana pool that even if you send multiple members, we'll just trim the wave with the ultimate and the Mystic Shot. Keep powering up that Mirror Mana transformation as early as possible. Now the bilge water for the sustain as well. So itemization, happy times for Pilot on one of these caster AD carries and making it work.
Well, is that mid lane tower really getting heavily chipped to Frozen, having trouble matching the wave clear, the instantaneous wave clear of Victor. So GBM has a very healthy advantage in that mid lane. Frozen still trying to stack that tier himself.
Super interested to see where he goes with the build, with the new flexibility. You know, now you have that much earlier back timing, picking up 1250 gold. Feels so good picking up the nearest large rod. And just having so many flexible options, both damage and utility. And for a champion like Cassiopeia, I really do love the Rylai's Liandry's, at least in theory. You know, I've played around with it a little bit in solo queue, but whether the pros actually look to adopt it in this matchup when you're going to have high health members from the top lane in the jungle, I think it's worth a consideration.
It is, but you know, the problem with Cassiopeia is not that she's not good with the new itemization, because she is one of the stronger champions with it. It's that when we see Cassiopeia played, frequently this is what happens. Trace in the enemy jungle right now. He's at the blue buff. He's doing a 1v2 duel. Spooky gonna follow up. Red buff burning onto Trace right now.
He's tanky. We're waiting for members from Jhin'Air to come and help, but
he's
at this present point, they're too far away. In Mininar, those resists are gone. That health is gone, and so is Trace.
But the blue buff might also be gone as Jhin'Air takes it away, gives it to GBM, so draws them out, so they at least get something in return for that kill. But Trace playing it a bit fast and loose right there. He only has a Hex Drinker and a Cowl. He's not in a great position in terms of his tankiness yet to really be dealing with some of these invades. But as I was saying with Cassiopeia, the problem is that we frequently see her just getting bullied out by these wave clear mid laners. And once that mid turret goes down, it becomes extremely difficult to keep control over your jungle with this champion.
Laning phase was actually one of the strengths of Cassiopeia maybe 3-4 months ago. But with the introduction of so many popular meta champions that have basically instant line wave clear, I'm thinking Twisted Fate and Victor squarely, or just wave clear that outclasses Cassiopeia, needs to prune down those minion waves, then of course gets the nice mana sustain from the E. And of course that mana sustain was even target nerfed, so just the laning phase is so much more difficult. And as you mentioned, the downside is, if you rotate around it, if you take down her outer turret, You can just freely outpush her if you're Victor and do your best Faker impression and walk all over the map.
Yeah, just so that game that we saw Faker play against the Ku Tigers when he had the Victor matchup into the Cassiopeia. Of course, that was pre-item changes. Sure. It was on 5.12. But even so, there are now deep wards on both sides of IM's jungle, and they're going to continue to get those deep wards in. And that means that GBM can wander wherever he pleases.
I guess my excitement, though, is, Monte Cristo, that you always have to think about the risk-reward. Now, if you're a bit smarter about rotating around your Cassiopeia, does the new itemization justify the upside of the Rylai's and Liandry's leading to slow potential to really chip down? You know, the poke damage of the Q is now suddenly something that has to be respected just because of the higher ability power and the natural burn from the Liandry's. You know, reward, you know, risk reward is always something that's changed by patch notes. So we're getting more information here. It's still going to be the Archangel's Rush. And again, just talking about the different itemization choices, Neosarge Rod, happy to build into the Archangel.
Goes into everything.
Everything, absolutely. I mean, Ampto literally builds into everything.
It's true.
Question. Look, well held the whole game, 50 CS disadvantage. That's definitely on the higher side of what we expect out of a matchup that's not the best from Maokai.
And here comes the Roams with the Victor. How safe is IM?
They have a turret to go back to.
They do. No dive. Frozen making his way over there would make a turret dive particularly dangerous. 30 seconds now until the second dragon of the game will be available for the take. Spooky going to make a play. There's a Chilling Smite down to Pilot. There's the knockup coming out of the Unfurl. Pilot starting to kite. Does he have to use his Summoner's Field? Oh, Spooky has overextended. And now there's a TP coming in from both teams, top laners. Uh-oh. GBM the first to respond. He is going to have the angle right here. There's the Death Ray. He gets caught up by Expression. Cleanse used. Now we see the zoning from the Gravity Field. Sodstar still at risk. Does get stunned. Does get popped by the Chaos Storm. And now Ignar the target. He's going to fall to a stun too. Trace still there. Trace about to hit that Meganar. Will they dive? No. Petrifying Gaze hits three. GBM gets targeted down with the Twin Fangs. And that's going to be the conclusion of that by 2-for-2 when the dust settles.
And you can just see the difference in experience between a player like Frozen and a player like Spooky. Spooky got far too trigger happy, got in there, was just getting kited back by Pilot. Of course, it's Ezreal has the most ability to open space of any AD carry next to Corki, and just had the item times to both sustain and put out damage. We'll watch this. So Spooky, remember, Alice is not in position for this gank, not impacting it whatsoever with his suite of CC. Spooky's getting kited backwards, bilge water, then just into this burst damage. Goes down. We see the teleports come through. You can see from the mini-map that Victor and Grimes can just make the more aggressive rotation down to bottom lane. So as this fight goes on, remember, Frozen doesn't get trigger-happy himself and use the ultimate. So that's the reason why, towards the end, we'll see the answering kill from a smart Haunting Gust.
Yeah, too true. And it was actually a preferable fight for Jhenair because they did get the initial kill onto Spooky.
Three-man. As a hero.
And, you know, at this level of play, we expect players to turn their back on that. We've seen CJ, for example, which are a better team fighting team than Jhenair, completely nullify Cassiopeia's by all four of them turning their backs. You have to be ready for that. You need to know as a team if that ultimate is still up. And what an obvious place to use that ult, too, if you are Frozen just to get out. So pretty sloppy there, actually, from Jhenair, at least. Two of those people should not have been hit by that.
Unfortunately, sloppy teamfight play has been the case today. That's not been the strength of this Jhenair team. It's all been about rotations. IM have started this dragon. This will be their first dragon. Gnar is not in position to contest.
But here's the collapse afterward. Jhenair still looking for that fight. Glacial Fissure will catch Ignar, forces that Unbreakable Will out. GBM here, and Ignar is going to die eventually, but he does actually zone off the rest of the team. However, Jhenair now has an angle into this mid lane.
Trace didn't have Meganar, couldn't cultivate it. It's now actually building up Rage onto Expression.
Oh, do they want to go for this? No, but they do get the Flash.
Trace didn't have Flash himself. Don't think he actually had the ability to push Expression back into the team. With this position on mid, Spooky in particular caught out of position. A lot of damage so far.
Just going huge Death Ray, actually. Pops the Chaos Storm. Doesn't really hit anybody, but it is threatening enough that Jhenair will get the tower.
I am just one interested in keeping this turret up, whether that was communication or just decision-making. Spooky was out of position. Cogmore stayed in the bottom lane to maybe get some sort of turret trade, but with Pilot there, can't even do that. And another objective and more gold goes over to Jhenair. 7,500, close to 8,000 is the gold lead for Jhenair.
It is. So Jhenair once again jumping out to a massive gold advantage in the early game. Last game, they sort of ran out of steam at this point and couldn't figure out a proper way to close.
Frozen is going for the Rylai's. The Leandre's not guaranteed, but it's looking like at least the potential Rylai's Leandre's that I've kind of heavily speculated about so far this series. Songstar's doing a good job pushing solo, but I believe Rek'Sai's been caught out by Vision, so maybe they'll be able to chip down this turret, maybe not.
Yeah, Songstar really doing some work here with that red buff, harassing Pilot's Ezreal. There's not a lot of response to that Bioarcane Barrage poke that's coming in.
Ezreal just doesn't have trading responses. You know, barring the especially non-AB Ezreal cooldown on the True Shot Barrage is respectable, so they will eventually get this turret. But they've invested three members in it so far, and Gragas is on the chase.
And here we go. Chaser on his way in right now. Songstar on the run. He's very low when it comes to HP. Explosive Casting is going to catch out Ignar, but that Alistar ult will save him for the moment. Frozen is here. They have to be careful. So looks like Jhin'Air not going to commit to this. Wise, but they save their turret. And Songstar barely gets out. Did have that summoner heal. Should he be under more threat? But GBM going to take this time. Again, clear out those mid lane waves. Make a play onto the top side right now. Jhin'Air with more and more turret. Oh, Ignar. Flashbolt misses, and that's a dead Alistar. Spooky going to come in. Songstar still low. Songstar has no mana. Pilot is caught out under the turret. There's a Petrifying Gaze. Shut down onto Pilot's Ezreal, but they cannot defend their tier two right now. GBM and Trace, free tower in the top side.
A really nice animation canceling by Frozen to get the kill, but remember, visited bottom, then left, then was coming back to be involved in that fight. That was four members being used in bottom, and GBM could just go help Trace as they push down the outer turret in top and get chip damage onto the inhibitor turret. Just using more resources for an even kill trade. It's a big problem for IM.
Yeah, it is. Even turret trade too, but that tier two in response to a tier one. They also lost some golden experience off of these minion waves. Nobody picking them up in mid and top, so.
Pilot's so much stronger than an AD carry Ezreal should be at this stage in the game. Now has the Blade of the Ruin King's not even going for Trinity Force.
No Muramana yet, by the way.
That's crazy to me that he doesn't have
23 minutes.
Maybe just rotational play. I guess I haven't really kept close tabs, but I expected a 20-minute Muramana.
Yeah.
When we're talking about, what, a 4-minute tier? 3.5-minute tier?
3.5-minute, yeah. Taking a look at that difference in gold right now. Trace, for
there
once, actually fed.
And just now, so 23 minutes was the eventual transform. Probably about 2.5-3 minutes later than I expected.
Well, that's a very large lead for Trace. He's uncomfortable with the situation, possibly. He doesn't know what to do when he's gotten so much gold in a game already.
I mean, just has to think back to what sort of a man he was 2 years ago and do his best impression. Because remember, he's not used that for selfish stats. It's not the Black Cleaver now that, of course, Marin was incessantly putting out yesterday, whether he was on the advantage or not. This is the my father more defensive, but it's a team fighting build, so despite having that selfish advantage, it's not like he's that much better at punishing Expression in a 1v1.
Fair enough.
Expression hasn't been able to build magic resist. It's something that's just deceptive, but when you max out that hyper, it's a lot of magic damage when we're talking about the ramping auto attack.
And also, just look at Victor right now. If you get in range of that Abyssal, he can just melt the front line because GBM has quite a few items already. Victor burst damage will do work even though Expression has that damage reduction percentage, by percentage ultimate.
Frozen might be forced into the Abyssal even if Leandre's might be the higher damage choice just because no null magic mana doesn't really matter if you have a high health total. You're going to be chunked out to below a third instantly.
And you have to say too, it's very important that IM get an Aegis here and they're not even close to that.
I mean, at the buff moment. Armor is the only real luxury purchase that Spooky's been able to pick up, and it's, look, maybe that's just from how much free damage you took from Pilot, but you're right. An Aegis is not a luxury. An Aegis is an absolute essential. On the food pyramid, it's right there. It's an essential.
So it's at the base of the LOL pyramid, that's Aegis right. Of the Legion. Everybody buy it right now.
I mean, like, how would you feel about an extra 100 magic resist for your team? Feels pretty good.
I like that. Especially against a Victor. Seems pretty nice. Okay, well, another setup for the Dragon right now. I am not really in position to go ahead and take this one. Void Rush will come through from the Spooky.
Expression has the Home Guard teleports, so they can look for a place. The Slippy Slide is enacted by Spooky.
They have the Pig Ward there.
Mm-hmm.
So see.
Where's the flank wall? There's one towards the bottom end of the pit. That's actually a pretty good advanced one that hasn't been spotted out by a pink. So Expression has options. But they need to start making a move, and making it soon.
And here comes that move. GBM is going to have to kite back very quickly. TP not going to find a target, but they do have Trace isolate on the side. Spooky goes in. There's the ult from Ignar, too. But there's a true shot rush. Nearly takes out Spooky. Trace and Expression duking it out on the side, but Ignar is just left. IM split up, and there is Frozen just annihilated by an R ultimate. Double kill for GBM, and Expression bites the dust for a triple, and that will be a Baron for the Jhin'Air Green Wings. If you are IM right there, you have to commit to one side or another. You can't play around with this Gnar with your frontline or Maokai.
But there's bigger problems than Monte Cristo. Unfortunately, it's the reality of playing your first game on the big stage. We saw the overchase by Spooky onto Ezreal earlier. This time, he was just so far away from his team. He was literally on 100 health before anyone else had impacted the team fight. And so Ignar died for free in the front line with the ult up. Gnar eventually got into the back line. The synergy and the calls between... See Sunstar trying to solo this dragon now, but GBM's thinking about killing Sunstar.
There's the Chaos Storm. Heal has to be used and the Flash. So GBM will walk away with a smile on his face.
But it can go two ways with this, with the jungle support duos. Of course, we saw Peekaboo come onto the scene as an experienced player, but really synergize well with Score. Spooky and his team this game, completely different playbooks, unfortunately.
Yeah, the calls have been quite conflicted when it comes to skirmishing or team fighting. With Spooky, and Jhin'Air saves the dragon for themselves. They don't really need it. They can take it quickly as they push up the waves and then go for Baron. Let's take a look at this team fight again.
Spooky's nowhere near his team. He's almost dead before anything else has happened. So Expression's actually tagging up with Trace, which, given how this game has gone, is perfect. If the engage could have been anywhere near relevant in the back line, it could have been a different fight. But once that happened, it was all over.
Well,
once Chris did.
IM was trying to engage on two fronts at once, basically, because they were tying up the Gnar. But had everybody actually just collapsed onto the Gnar, it could have been a very different story for them. Because Jhin'Air was spread out pretty far. That was an abusable situation.
Well, I mean, Spooky was basically doing a Jarvan an impression. It was almost like the max range EQ ult screens away from your team. There's just no way for the rest of his team to collapse onto that engagement. Ignar couldn't get in range, and that's been the story this whole time. Whenever we see the ganks in bot, Ignar has never been able to hit a relevant headbutt pulverize, despite being excellent at that ability.
And here we go, GBM locked out. Cleanse comes through immediately. Here's the Kaiden coming in. Pilot is untouched, and GBM starting to annihilate people. With all that AoE, Frozen gets caught. Triple kill already for Pilot. Quadra kill. Sunstar is here. Can Pilot get the pentakill? He's got to get it. Pentakill for Pilot on the Ezreal as he cleans up the fight. He was untouched in that team fight.
Completely untouched. Doesn't even need the Trinity Force. Just with his suite of armor penetration and the play of the Ruined King. That was the engage IM needed. But when they were even in gold, when they were ahead in gold, not 15,000 gold behind.
Yeah, nothing you can do right there. Another, we've had so many pentakills this season.
I brought them with me from the LPL, Monte Cristo.
Wow. Well, nice kiting there from Jhin'Air. That is what they're good at. They may have problems in some of these other kind of team fights, but he can pull that off. And let's take a look at the pentakill right here.
And this is what Ignar finally was able to do. Very nice headbutt. Pulverize onto three members. They get the Wombo engage, but they're so far behind items. There's that Aegis Monte Cristo, it was nowhere to be seen.
Nope, not at all. Pilot gets a good True Shot Barrage, hitting multiple people. And it was just mostly cleanup from Pilot, honestly. But everybody tried to dive onto GBM, but GBM had the fast fingers on the cleanse, so he got the kite, and there is the pentakill. His buddy Trace taking a turret.
And look, finally has the Sheen in the inventory, but it's nice to see players walk away from the Trinity Force being a core. It's still a wonderful item on Ezreal, but he was able to achieve so much power with just the Mirror Mana, Blade the Ruined King, and Last Whisper.
Yes, I think this is the more common Ezreal build that we see in Korea, where you go for the Trinity Force as a fourth or fifth item.
It goes from being a core to a luxury, which
yeah.
is interesting, just given the global meta and how ingrained it is to get the Trinity Force and Ezreal to buff around the Mystic Shard. I mean, the gold lead at this point is just disgusting. So we're waiting for Jhin'Air to organize an end. Is Ignar? Yep, he's reminding us, can hit headbutt pulverize.
Well, to Jhin'Air's credit, too, this game, they've done a much better job of closing. 30 minutes into this one, they've been playing more aggressively. They've been pushing the limits.
And we needed to be convinced of that, because the CJ series, the previous game, question marks for Jhené's ability to close. Look, they haven't done it yet, so maybe we're just saying worrying things. Trace has the Mega Gnar transformation. He could Mega Gnar them all onto the turret, but unlike Spooky, understands it's far too far away from his team.
And here we go. IM pops the Righteous Void. They want to come in on the Zignar. No mana, so he's going to have some trouble. And that is going to be him falling immediately. And there's the Gnar. Gets some people back in the fight. Frozen has the face of the mountain, but does fall to the Chaos Storm. And Trace, he's on a mission to not die to the tower. Everybody just running in. Super minions onto the Nexus. They want Sonstar. They're going to get Sonstar. You poor, sad Kog'Maw.
The reindeer that couldn't be. Unfortunately, this time Rudolph couldn't make it done. He couldn't save Christmas, or the base for that matter. And a very nice end to what has been a much more decisive win for Jhené Greenwing.
Well, Rudolph can't save Christmas when he's dead, Papa Smithy.
Nope.
That makes all the children cry. So there we go. Nexus will fall eventually. I guess they want to pad their KDA. Nope, minions will take it out. Super Minion with the last blow, and that is a 2-0 victory for the Jhené Green Wings. Much more convincing in Game 2.
In fact, my only contention is who gets the MVP, Monte Cristo? 11-1-7 is the victor. Pentakill award or just the MVP? We have to wait and see.
Trace also played that very nicely. He really set up some nice Gnar ults, and he was responsible for turning around that teamfight at Dragon that really gave the advantage over.
For all your statisticians, I can confirm over 80% kill participation for Chaser as well, so probably going to stay up the top as well.
Number one for kill contribution.
I mean, Sweet himself did some interesting things, actually. Only 21 out of 23 kill participation for him. He was all